This month, we're asking for your support through our premium programs via the Escapist Plus and YouTube memberships. Your support allows us to continue making the content we want instead of chasing algorithms or the latest trends. Plus, you get a bunch of perks like ad-free viewing via the Escapist Plus on our main website, early access on YouTube via YouTube memberships. You can even ask us questions for our Ask the Creators video series. Thanks for all your support, whether it's with these programs or your general viewership. Hey there, Internet. My name is Jack Packard, and I've grown up a lot since before dinner. Here for The Escapist.
Hello, I'm Nick Calandra, the Twitter warrior of chief of The Escapist.
What? This week on The Escapist Show, we're going to talk about the games we've been playing, including Hitman and The Medium. And then over in the topics section, Nick and I are going to talk about our personal regrets as far as gaming is concerned. That's right, we're going to talk about games that we never got around to playing, but we think we should. So hello and welcome. This is The Escapist Show. So, Nick, I'll go first. Slightly Civil War, for an episode of Slightly Civil War that we recorded today, I needed to do a little bit of research on the Hitman series of video games, specifically the newer ones, which I never got around to playing when they first came out, though I always thought I would like them. So I spent last week playing some of the newer Hitman games, a few levels of the Hitman 1, which is not the first Hitman 1, it's the IOI Hitman 1. And you know what, had a pretty fun time doing it. I'm not sure if I quite get it yet. I really enjoy the idea of these Hitman games, this kind of like, you know, you have your mission and you get to figure out how to accomplish your goal along the way. I like the open-endedness of it. I love, like, you know, the outfit change mechanic and blending in and certain people being able to spot you depending on your outfit. And I've been having a lot of fun with it. We talked about this a little bit on Slightly Civil War in the podcast, but the Hitman games are kind of at war with themselves as far as tone is concerned. You know, it's a very serious game, and you know, you're murdering people for money, but it's also a little goofy and a little tongue-in-cheek. You know, they're very schlocky about certain things, like, you know, you wear like a policeman's outfit and you walk past another policeman and he's like, "Oh, it's good to see a fellow policeman out here. Ha ha, so happy that you're my partner." I love the idea of unlocking new ways to replay each level, because that means you can have a lot of fun experimenting within the same realm. But that also like breaks a ton of like immediacy and immersion of the level you're on, because you know you can just do it again and in a different way. And I don't, you know, it's like, I get it. I don't know if I fully understand how good it is yet, but I feel like I want to.
Yeah, that's a series that I keep trying to play, and I don't feel engaged when I'm playing it. You know, there's some elements that you do, and like you can investigate and you just kind of follow people around and wait for that opportunity to get the perfect kill. And I'm not really into like the games where like you have to keep replaying things for a better score and all that. So that's why I've always kind of had a hard time getting through it. And yeah, actually, before IOI did the new Hitman Absolution was made, which was still like a stealth action game, but it was very narratively driven. Mm-hmm. And I really liked that one because I felt like I had something I was working towards. And these games, like, they're almost, I get the appeal of it. I guess it's just not for me. And that's why I was super excited to see it in VR, though, because just that extra level of interactivity and where, like, sure, you know, I can put myself in that situation, just mess around with things, because it's not really fun to just, I don't think it's fun to just go around, click A on an object, pick it up and do something with it. At least in VR, I can, you know, fool people. And, you know, when you look at the trailer for that game, like just tapping your target on the shoulder and then punching him in the face, that's hilarious. Like, but yeah, like I keep looking at Hitman 3 and like, yeah, you know, I really want to try it. And I know Hitman 1 and 2 have a story to go through, and I load them up, and I try to play through it, and I just get bored so quick.
You know, it's definitely more arcadey, where, you know, it's a very simple goal. You get to figure out different ways to do it. I can see how having, like, a lack of a story would be less compelling for you. For me, like, that's what I like about it.
Right.
It's like, yeah, you don't need to worry about, like, the overarching story. Like, here is a simple, well-defined set of parameters, and more importantly, it's not an action game at all. They have stripped away all of the action elements. It's just stealth, changing outfits, hiding behind things, setting up the dominoes so you can watch them fall. And most importantly, the biggest thing, the biggest moment of joy in any Hitman level is the level's not over until you walk out of the facility you're in, right?
Right.
And so, like, that feeling in your brain of, like, I did something none of these people know, and I'm just going to walk out the front door like I own the place, is the biggest victory in any game. I love that feeling so much.
Yeah, I probably just haven't put enough time into it, because I feel like I would like it if I spent more time with it. It's just, yeah, it's just one of those games that just hasn't clicked for me.
Well, and I'll tell you, it's the same for me, where it hasn't fully clicked. I feel like I'm getting there. I'm going to play a little bit more. I have a Stadia Pro membership, and 1 and 2 are free over on Stadia Pro, and so I've been just playing 1 and having a decent time. Big ups to Stadia. As I decided I want to play this game, I clicked one button and was able to play the game immediately. Big downside to Stadia, I tried to play it on my iPad, because you can play Stadia on iPads now, and with Wi-Fi connection, that was a bad time.
Yeah, I even have fiber, and it doesn't work on Wi-Fi really for me that well, so.
Oh boy. But yeah, overall, I'm having a very good time playing Hitman, and I'm going to dig into it a little bit more to see if I can fully understand why people love it so much. So Nick, what have you been playing?
So I played through The Medium, which is a new game from Bloober Team, who have made Layers of Fear 1 and 2 and Observer, which were like psychological horror games, kind of walking simulator-esque. The Medium is their first like cinematic horror, psychological horror game, where you play in a third-person view, and it's got like, well, it's not as cinematic as you think, but, well, actually, yes, it is. But it's got like the fixed camera angles like you would get out of a Resident Evil game or Silent Hill or whatever.
Oh, interesting.
And it's basically a point-and-click adventure game. That's essentially what it is.
Okay.
The story follows Marianne, and she's a medium, which means basically she's kind of stuck between two worlds. So she lives in the physical form, and she also has like a spirit form, and she helps trap spirits cross over to the other side. So the story kind of follows that, and like this mystery revolving around like how she got these powers. And a lot of the previews kind of played it up as like a Silent Hill type game.
Okay.
But it's really not. It's, you know, there's no combat in it. There's none of that. It's really not even scary. There's like one jump scare throughout the entire game. The plot is okay. Like, it's another one of those games where like every time you want to get more and more of the plot, you got to read through all the notes and everything.
Which, oh no.
Yeah. I really hate those games. Like, it just give me the story. Stop making me read stupid notes to get everything. I'm playing a video game. I don't want to read.
Yeah, I understand.
Unless it's like a RPG or whatever. Yeah. So it was a fun enough experience. It's not something that's going to win any Game of the Year awards. It's more indicative of like how Bloober Team has been evolving as a studio. And, you know, it was interesting enough for me to want to complete to the end.
Like, oh, okay.
But Marty and I kind of are talking about it a little bit too. And the ending is like, what? Yeah, there's not a whole lot to say about it. It's just, you know, it's been kind of hyped up a lot. And, you know, it's really your standard run of the mill. You know, walk, click on things, hear dialogue, read things.
Sounds like torture.
The most interesting thing about The Medium is like when it's actually doing puzzles with the next gen tech, like you are literally you have two instances of the game running at the same time, as you can see her in the physical world and the spirit world. And you have to navigate kind of at the same time around these different paths, which is interesting. You know, the things you do in the spirit world can affect things in the physical world and all that. But it's not really anything in depth. Like, it's very, very simple puzzles that your mother could figure out if she played the game. With how small Bloober Team is and all that, I'm not surprised. Like, it's not, it didn't go more in depth, but I really think, like, if people like the game and it does well on Game Pass and everything,
yeah,
like, that's a concept they could definitely expand on and make really interesting. Because, like,
that's it's a concept in games that has been done for 30 years at this point. I mean, yeah,
maybe not so much in horror games, though.
Link to the Past, Metroid, the Dark One, Dishonored 2 had a...
Well, but that's not... You're not playing those in the very same instance, though. They're like, you're in one dimension, you enter another dimension. In the medium, you play both at the same exact time.
Oh, maybe I'm not understanding that, yeah.
Yeah, if you go watch the footage, it'll make more sense. But basically, like, you're controlling two characters at the same time in two different worlds, interacting with one another. I can't really spoil one of the cooler aspects of the game and how it could, if they expand on it, make a horror game actually really, really interesting.
Sure.
But I think once people play it, and they'll kind of get that part of it, be excited about that, even though it's really mechanically not well put together in the medium. So, yeah, Yahtzee's going to do his EP on it. I'm sure he's not going to like it.
Hey.
But we'll see.
So, Nick, let's move over to the topics. Very similar to Hitman, which has been on my kind of two playlist for a long time, but that kind of prompted us to talk about our biggest gaming regrets, as far as like games that have been on our list forever and we just haven't gotten to. So, you know what? I'm going to start with one of mine. I have two that I've been able to come up with as far as like games that I've always wanted to dive deep into and never got a chance. One is Dead Space, which many people consider to be a horror classic.
Me included.
I myself am a huge horror fan. I also am a big sci-fi fan. I have played approximately 1 hour of Dead Space on a stream 8 years ago at this point. I own a copy of Dead Space. I've just never dug deep into it. Every once in a while, I'll even install it just to say, oh, I'm gonna play it. And it never comes up. Everything gets in the way and I want to play it.
So you tried it and you put it down?
Well, it was on stream.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you never get it. And I started it on stream, which is always a big, big mistake because then you can't focus on the game. I feel like I have never played it because I only played it on stream.
Dead Space has everything that you would like in a horror game. Lots of gore, great combat, great scares, great atmosphere and tension. And there's no hiding.
Yes.
Yeah.
Why haven't I played it yet? Because things keep moving up the list.
You will try it for Thursday on Today We Try.
No, I won't play it on Today We Try because that's the problem, you see. This is true for any game. Our very premise of Today We Try is very flawed.
Yeah.
Because if you play a game for the first time on stream, you are only half paying attention to the game and therefore not taking it fully in. So no.
Yeah, Dead Space is a game that you have to play in the dark with a good sound system on to really...
Right.
And it took me... Oh man, it took me like 4 years to beat that game. It just scared the piss out of me when it came out. Just this utterly oppressive atmosphere throughout the entire experience. It's exhausting. But I love it.
I'm really looking forward to it. You know, maybe I'm just gonna clear all of my October, and that'll be like my Halloween game. Is like if I schedule it, and I don't have to like feel like it's like, oh no, I know what I'm playing this October. You know, that'll be that. So how about something on your list, Nick? What's a game that you've never gotten around to playing?
So I have never played a Legend of Zelda game. Until Breath of the Wild, which I completed.
It's a good one.
Yes. And it's partially because I didn't own a 64 growing up, so I didn't really start with Zelda. I don't remember if there were any good ones on GameCube.
Wind Waker was on GameCube.
Well,
little
do I know.
One of arguably the best Zeldas out there.
Yeah, so I just never got into... I played some games on my GameCube, but once I got a PS2, like that's where I spent most of my time. Zelda's a series that I should like, and it's probably just because I haven't given time to it, because I love like Darksiders, which was inspired by Zelda. I've played a lot of, even the kind of the Dark Souls series inspired by Zelda a little bit, right?
Well, the Dark Souls series was inspired by Zelda 1, yeah.
I don't mind like high fantasy, light fantasy, but I do like dark fantasy a lot more.
Sure.
In my games, so that's probably why I never played it. And it's also why I don't play a lot of JRPGs, because a lot of them are kind of like that light fantasy, I guess. Or like anime and manga and stuff like that. I just never got into that stuff.
I think like calling Zelda light fantasy is pretty accurate.
Yeah. What's really funny is every time I played Smash, Link was my main character every game. So,
pretty good.
I don't know. That if that tells you, my gaming horizon was very, very small when I was growing up.
To me, it's really funny because, of course, you're younger than I am. So for you, you were talking about like the N64 as your barrier. And for me, I'm thinking like, oh, Super what Nintendo. About Super Nintendo or NES, which I grew up with.
Right.
And so it's really funny for you to be like, yeah, never got around to the N64 version. It's like there were a million other games before that.
Only 25. Don't have those gray hairs yet.
You're a baby and that's okay. Yeah, and you know, like the original The Legend of Zelda for the NES, like I think for like as a gaming commentator and historian, you should play it at least once just to kind of understand where it all came from.
Right.
Like the whole idea of like Nintendo hard, death kills you and you have to start from the beginning, like Dark Souls, like all comes from that original Legend of Zelda, like the joy of discovery. But it's an NES game. It doesn't look the greatest.
Yes, and it's not even the graphics that are like make it hard for me to go back to the, it's just like the improvement in mechanics over the years, and you know, but also it's hard for me to go back and play games I miss because of my job, so.
Right. I would say, as someone who has played all, I want to say all of the Legend of Zelda games, except for, you know, the CDI ones, is I would look to two places to start here. One, maybe check out Link to the Past, the Super Nintendo top-down Zelda. I think that's one, it's a fantastic game. Two, it's got the light world, dark world thing, huh? So you do a little medium there. And it's like a really prime example of the game that exploded that genre of like top-down adventure. Really fun, interesting game. If you can't go back that far as retro graphics are concerned, Wind Waker. It's still one of my favorite The Legend of Zelda games, especially the HD remake, which cuts out a lot of fat and improves some mechanics. Fantastic game.
Yeah, the other one I was looking at was Ocarina of Time.
That looks bad, I'll tell you that. Ocarina looks bad. Like, the 64 graphics looks terrible. And so, like, if you're looking for all of the adventure of Ocarina but a better wrapper, Wind Waker is your best bet. Because Ocarina's rough sometimes.
Yeah.
It's really ugly.
All right, what's your second gaming regret?
So I was looking through games, you know, like I basically just looked through like a list of popular games throughout the years to figure out a series of games that I never played that, looking back, I think I would really love. And I came across the big daddy, the mother of them all, the game that I've never ever played but think that I would super be into: World of Warcraft.
Never played it either.
It is a certifiable gaming phenomenon. Never played it.
Yeah.
One, I didn't grow up with a gaming computer, so I just couldn't. I didn't grow up with any computer, in fact, because, you know, computers weren't a thing. And then even when my family got a computer, it was pretty garbage. We didn't play games on it. I wasn't a gaming PC kind of person. Also, I've always been into that kind of high fantasy thing, but very recently, as I play more Dungeons and Dragons, I am becoming more immersed in the world of high fantasy and am enjoying it even more.
Yeah, it's one of those games that everybody I knew was playing when I was growing up, but I just never found the urge to play it, and mostly just because I know how much MMOs are a time investment. And I just never had the desire to invest that much time, which is kind of stupid to say considering I spent like hundreds of hours playing the same fucking map in Halo over and over and over again. But yeah, I've never gotten into any of the MMOs.
Yeah, neither have I. Like, I've, you know, played some online games and enjoyed myself. Never any MMO, especially like a MMORPGA, like a World of Warcraft. But I know like WoW Classic is out there, and in general, people seem to like it, where it's a very trimmed down version of WoW, and just play some classic campaigns. I think, like, for me, the hard part about getting into that now would be, can you do it solo? Like, can I just play the game by myself, or do I need to find like a clan to go with, that sort of thing?
Well, MMOs are massively multiplayer online games, so they do involve a big social element.
Right, and it's hard enough to schedule D&D games right. with people I know in real life. Now I gotta find people to play an MMO with, so it's probably not going to happen anytime soon. But we'll see.
Yeah, and the only other reason I can think I never really played that is because I didn't really like the top-down action RPG style. Like, I didn't like the click combat all the time.
Sure.
My tastes have always revolved around, like, shooters or action RPGs or whatever, where I have direct control over the action, or I feel like I have direct control over the action.
That, like, immediate action response. Yep. I pull a trigger, and it pulls a trigger in the game. Not like I click a mouse button, and my character throws a fireball.
Yeah.
Right, yeah.
Lightning bolt! Lightning bolt! Lightning bolt!
So how about you? What else is on your list of games you wish you played?
So the one game that I keep hovering over the buy button for, and I just will not let myself pull the trigger, is the Final Fantasy VII Remake.
Ooh.
I have never played through any of the Final Fantasy games. I had Crystal Chronicles on the GameCube, and I think I put an hour into it, and I didn't get it. I would come back to it every once in a while. Like, I like the music of this, I like the art of it. I just can't get it. I can't get into it.
Okay, and I've played a bunch of Final Fantasy games, mostly because, you know, they were on the Super Nintendo, and they're fun-ish. Don't start with Final Fantasy VII Remake. That's a bad place.
Well, the reason I'm looking at that one is because, like, it's a more modern action RPG, which might get me into the series. Because I was looking at Final Fantasy 15 as well.
Mm.
The one they just announced looks pretty good. I'm actually interested in trying that when that comes out. But I, like, for whatever reason, I never really got into the JRPG combat of those types of games. And, you know, recently this past year, as you know, I went back and played Dragon Quest 11, which I never played a Dragon Quest game before, and I really liked that, so I figured, you know, these Final Fantasy games are actually probably up my alley. I've just never pulled the trigger and tried it.
You know, I really like that combat. It can get repetitive and very boring, especially like if you're fighting the same low-level enemy over and over again. But I kind of dig that combat just because then you can really take your time and pick what you want to do. I was a big fan of Final Fantasy X or Final Fantasy X, whatever you want to call them. You know, graphically at the time, at the time, maybe not right now, but graphically at the time, it was gorgeous. We had real like CG cutscenes. It looked really cool.
I do remember those.
I really liked the characters, and you know, it had some really awful cheesy sections. But to me, like, that was a really fun time. I even liked Final Fantasy X-2, where you got to do Charlie's Angels, dress him up.
Yeah, I think it was just another instance of, like, you know, I do find, like, a lot of the JRPG games just almost too cheesy for me to really get into.
Mm-hmm.
I like the more dark fantasy grounded kind of stuff like that, you know, Skyrim or, you know, Dragon Age, call that kind of stuff. I guess Western RPGs in general. But yeah, like, everything I've heard about Final Fantasy is, like, you know, the characters are great, the stories are all great. I just gotta pull the trigger if I want to try it.
I could definitely see, like, you pulling the trigger on one and it not being your thing, but of course there's approximately 1,000 Final Fantasy games, and so it's like finding the right one.
That's the other stopgap. Which one do I start with? 7 sounded pretty good. The only JRPGs I ever really played growing up were, I played some of the Pokemon games.
Sure.
And Emerald's like one of my favorite games I've ever played. I also played one of the Fire Emblem games. I did like that.
Okay.
That's probably it.
And that's okay. Like, yeah, you don't need to play them all. Yeah, that's just, you know, there's some fun in there. And I don't know, while I really like that kind of turn-based combat, it's definitely not for everybody,
right?
Especially by modern standards.
Well, yeah, and that's, you know, that's what I kind of took away from playing Divinity Original Sin 2, is I really liked that combat because I had to think and strategize a lot more than you feel like right. You have to do in a JRPG where you're just kind of clicking attack, you know?
You're in a row and you click attack.
Yep, I want more agency with it.
Yeah, I'm with you. All right, well, great. I feel like that was a pretty good episode where we talked about some things, also stuff. So thanks everybody for listening and or watching this. Once again, I have been Jack Packard, semi-professional video game enjoyer here for The Escapists.
Let us know in the comments what games you haven't played so we can make fun of you, because we know you're going to make fun of us.
We're going to get a lot of that. We can't play them all, everybody. We just can't.
We're games journalists. We're supposed to play everything and know everything about games.
That's true, and we do. But we can't. But we do.
Wait. Do we know everything?
Yes.
Okay. As long as we both agree on that. Oh, you don't agree?
I do.
Oh, okay. Well, then we're good. My name is Nick Langer, the editor-chief of The Escapist, and I know everything about everything, including about you. Yes, you.
Terry.